So, last year, 50 babies were born, and we initiated 25 children as adults. The clan has 17 more people, 83 more head of cattle, and 36 more horses than we did last sacred time. I think we got a few more than that. Anyway, we produced 1,179 and ate 1,378 bushels of food. 130 were lost due to spoilage. Ah, yeah, we should be careful about our food this year then. Our crafters produced 182 cows worth of goods, and our markets made a profit of 54 cows worth of goods. Okay, so our crafters produced more, but the markets themselves definitely didn't do as well as the previous year. And the shrines and temples are still taking the same amount as last time as well. Anyway, the forecast. Our God Talkers predict a more or less normal harvest. Well, they got it wrong last time. And a kingdom to the far northwest figured in their visions. They said we should make a trip there. Okay. Is that Tarth? Tarsh? Something like that. Okay, right. We do our usual. We want 2 in diplomacy, of course. 1 in war. It looks like we're being attacked fairly frequently now. Again, I kind of want to do another hero quest, but we don't really have the magic for it just yet. So we'll put another point into destiny. Do we put a point into heroism as well? No, we're trying preserve clan magic a bit more. A fantastic news about Enant. Thanks to her many trips to local cattle fairs and heartfelt offerings to Asari's, her ability to drive a hard but fair bargain ranks well above any ordinary woman's. Alright, so Enant is now a heroic bargainer. That's good. Right. Derek still valiantly evades his destiny. He does. He's 74 years old. Yeah. Oh! He's also leveled up his bargaining, so yeah. He's getting even stronger, and he's getting even older. I think it's 76 or 78 that I've seen the oldest person. So he's definitely trying to reach record levels of age. But I am expecting him to die within the next couple of years, so that's going to be an issue. Oh, and Gordegar's portrait has changed as well. He's looking even more bedraggled than usual. Anyway, let's get on with it. 54 hunters. So we do need to reduce their numbers. Back down to 48 they go. Yeah, 4 renowned plus skill. So renowned, renowned, heroic, renowned. And 1 of excellent. I mean, I've never seen quite so many renowned or above skills on one person. I've seen 2 heroic and 1 renowned before. Man, that's... yeah. That was quite the fanfare, wasn't it? Anyway. Right, so, even the farmers aren't complaining, for once. Right, Just going through the different blessings. Tempting to get the feared women blessing up and running again. Yeah, I think that's probably a good idea. Yep, Vingo's happy with that. Mood down, farm morale down. Your carls come together to warn the clan ring that your Tula cannot support its population. There are too many people now. We can't produce enough food for everyone. Could trade for more food, but soon we'll be in the same fix again. People will starve if we don't do something. Some of them suggest that that about a quarter of the clan should split off and go off to seek a new Tula of their own. Others say you should seize land from a neighbour. Yeah. We should raid the Jinstali clan, our cadet clan. Plants fair, yeah. I mean, yeah, that is worth pointing out though, Nemaxis. He has skill in all levels of management in this game now. So, yeah. Even though Long Pork Mookie says, listen. No long pork. Long pork bad. Long pork make you crazy. Right, so we should raid the Jinstali clan. No, we shouldn't raid our cadet clan. We've already split the clan off once. We must split up. If we send the discontented families off, the ones who stay behind will be free from their griping. raiding for land is very risky and will ruin our chances at planting enough food to see us through another year. That's a good point, actually. Right, this is not at all unusual. Orlanthi clans split up every few generations. We split off from our old clan in Hjortland. Those best equipped to survive are the wealthiest families. They'll take more than a quarter of the livestock, food and goods if they go. The worst troublemakers have the fewest cows, so sending them away will impoverish us the least. When Bad King Urgrain had to split up his clan, he sundered families and picked people at random. His people were so enraged that they all left him at once. So, Bad King Urgrain has been abandoned, murdered multiple times and in multiple ways, offended everyone in existence, and still gets to be called a king. Yeah. I mean, it's just... I understand that he is a lot more of a... more of a legend or a myth and a story than an actual figure at this point, but... Yeah... Who knows where the myth ends and the historical facts begin at this point. Anyway, okay, so yeah, they make a point. We can't attack another clan at this stage. It would ruin our chances at a good harvest. Although, with that said, we could offset that with trading for food. Difficult to say. Let's choose the worst troublemakers to split off. I mean, that will impact us the least. We gain magic and mood. Doesn't look like the numbers are going to be too badly affected. They were angry and complained a lot, but those who were staying were glad to be rid of them. They left for an unsettled part of Dragon Pass, taking their share of food, livestock and goods with them. As they were the laziest of us, their share was not as great as it might otherwise have been. People said that they would have a hard time of it, now they had to shift for themselves. We heard later that they were calling themselves the Ormarth Clan. Right, let's check the map to see where they've gone. They've gone up to the northeast. Right. Tash. Okay, so that's where the good talkers want an exploration to go. So okay, well, we've just had that happen. War. Are the Tree Brothers considered neighbours? They are. Well then. Okay, so this is what I think I'm going to do. We'll attack this turn, and then next turn I'll send an expedition off to Tash. See how that goes. Tree Brothers, yep. Tree Brothers are the target. Let's get the Gensdali in on this. Yeah, those numbers are pretty good. We'll add a few extra auxiliaries, though. 25 should be good. Right, here we go. The Gensdali sent 32 warriors. We eluded the Tree Brother patrols, and our 23 weapon thanes and 125 footmen are facing only 3 weapon thanes and 56 swordsmen. Ouch. I don't think we even need to make use of Elmul's amber this time, so we'll leave that as that. Do we burn steads? Or do we just try and kill as many as possible? I think we try and kill as many as possible. If we can push them away, that would be great for us, because it would push an angry clan further away from us, which makes them less likely to attack us in the future. We rushed the Tree Brother formation while they were still performing their rituals. Tree Brother warriors fight poorly. They slap at empty air and flinch when none of our warriors are near. Yorsar extends his spiritual sight and sees Orlanth's spirits of retribution. The impests, the swarming around the Tree Brothers. How should he fight against these oathbreakers the rest of the battle? Combat, very good. Okay, let's... Fight bravely, press the enemy hard. That should be fairly good for a very good... Oh, excellent fighter. So, yeah, we'll do that. Yorsar took note of the Tree Brothers who were most afflicted by the impests. He sent deadly arrows whizzing against the men who Orlanth wanted punished, striking them down before they knew their danger. Well, there we go. There was a bloody battle. Their magic was stronger than ours, but we were not dismayed. We drove the Tree Brothers from the battlefield, striking them down as they fled. Our share of the plunder was 18 cows and 2 horses. Our auxiliaries were able to heal 2 of our warriors. Other than that, it was a flawless victory. We killed one of their elites and 11 of their footmen. Spearmen, I believe. But yeah, we've caused them quite a bit of grief, haven't we? Wow, sounds like they really wanted the Tree Brothers to live. Leaf. Yes, indeed, Liz. Also, hello, Liz. Didn't mention it earlier, but hello, Liz. Right, so yes, I said that this turn I would send an expedition out to Tarsh. So let us do just that. Good luck, Brangbane. Hope they don't branch out. Oh dear. The puns keep coming and they don't stop coming, do they? I love it. Love it. Right. Five weapon thanes. And I'm going to get you to move swiftly because this is pretty much right at the edge of the map. We'll put you right there. Oh no. Rumour has it that certain unmarried young men of the clan have been heading into the woods to visit a beautiful woman, one who doesn't dress or act like an Orlanthi. May even be that some married men have been with her, breaking the laws against adultery. Right. Do we interrogate the menfolk to see who has been with her, remind the menfolk of the penalties for adultery, send a search party to capture the woman, and send a party to drive the woman off? Or just say, these are just rumours, wait for facts. Gordengar has something to say right away. What a pack of worrying prudes. Our menfolk no doubt gave her a rougher time than she gave them. Hunt her down and kill her. Begone, thought! I told you the forests were dangerous. She is a wood nymph. If men were with her, they're in some kind of trouble. She is a wood nymph. If men were with her, she'd have made their flesh soil for something terrible sprouting. Investigating who is the sap. Oh, nice. I will subtly question the menfolk and determine what involvement they have had with this creature. Yeah. We're going to have to interrogate. Three men admitted to having been with the woman, who said that she had... eyes that were impossible to resist. What do you do? Perform a ritual to lift any curses they might be under. The God Talkers said that the ritual had it succeeded, but that did cost us two magic. Oh man, that... Hey, Omega! Good to see you! Thanks for the raid. Indeed. Stay a while. Stay forever. Oh, good to see you. I know what you've been playing, but let's give you a shout out. Oh, and the real Lorebot as well. Good to see you too. I'll give you a shout out in a moment as well. But there we go. If you don't already follow Omega, go give him a follow. He's a slime that plays games good. And was playing Death Stranding, yeah, there we go, earlier. I was in his stream earlier today, ran into an incident which I resolved with violence, and one which I resolved with the same process. It do be that way sometimes, Omega. Sometimes you just got to be decisive, that's the thing. But yes, I was in your stream earlier, and you were having fun in the forest for a while. I think you mean you failed to resolve it with oh dear. And you ran out of ammo and practiced running. Okay, I mean. Sometimes you just got to run away. I mean, what was it that the orcs like to say about fighting? If you win, you get to fight some more. If you lose, it doesn't matter because you're dead. And but if you run away, you can come back and have another go. So yes, I do not fault you for having to fall back. But yeah, I mean, if you run out of ammo, you kind of have to run. But yeah, I wonder, there is usually a cooldown period for the shoutouts. The real lore bot. Yes, there we go. So yes, the real lore bot also does a fair bit of streaming fairly regularly. And last time I saw was also playing Death Stranding. It seems like Death Stranding's seeing a bit of a popularity spike around here. But no worries. You're quite welcome. So yes, if you don't follow these guys yet, I really would suggest giving them a follow. Right, am I following? Huh. Apparently I did. I'm pretty sure I followed you, Lorebot. But apparently not, but oh well. There we go. Yeah, I think it was Wild Burke that I saw playing Death Stranding a few days ago. I was wondering if that was going to cause a bit of a chain reaction. It is one of those games. It is one of those games that when you see it being played, it's like, yeah, that would be kind of chill to play. And then you just want to stream it. So, yeah. Also, hello, Variax. Good to see you. And now you're... you're advising running away. Good to see you. I'll give you a shout out in a moment. There's already been two shout outs just now, so we'll give you another shout out in a moment. Yeah, I've played a little bit of Death Stranding. It's it's nice to chill out to, but I would prefer to be playing Euro Truck Simulator than Death Stranding. If I want a game to chill out to, I would prefer Euro Truck Simulator, because it's like Euro Truck Simulator, but every once in a while you get interrupted by moments of absolute violence. So yeah, the whiplash you can get from that game is it's real. Oh yeah, Death Stranding's incredibly relaxing, but as I say, you've got the tonal shift of delivering things from place to place, and then suddenly mindless violence breaks out. To be fair, Death Stranding isn't super different from Kojima's previous game, Metal Gear Solid 5. In a way, you kind of have a point there, Lorebot. Okay, I think it's time. Shout out. Big B Streams. There we go. Variax. Go give Variax a follow if you don't already. He also plays some very similar games to what I play. So if you like your Morrowinds, or you like your King of Dragon Passes, then you're definitely in good company by going to follow and watch Variax streaming. So, yes. Also, very slightly mad, which I can certainly appreciate. Marrow ones? Sounds nerdy. It's very nerdy, Variax. But the good kind of nerdy. Anyway, yes. And yeah, I definitely recommend you give King of Dragon Pass another go, Variax. I think it would do well to receive the Variax treatment. Anyway, yes. Earth season. So, we've done the fighting, we've done the exploring. Well, I say we've done the exploring, we've sent explorers out. Hopefully they won't be gone too long. But, 25 weapon things. Let's see if we can get some blessings going. We've already got quite a few decent blessings up and running already, so difficult to say what would be useful right now. I think it's a little too late to get the sun blessing going. Okay, maybe we won't do some magic stuff. In that case, let's continue buttering up the Orlundi. It seems like they like to turn up in our events fairly frequently, so... not trade. Relations. There we go. Emissary. We go to the Orlundi. So, Orlundi. And give gifts. And, right, let's send Brandig out, seeing as we've got Brangbane already doing something. Have I tried either of the Thayer games? I have indeed played the first Thayer game. I've seen the second Thayer game and thought, that looks a little too different. I'm not sure what to make that one. So I haven't played the second one yet, but yeah, I have played Thayer. And it's an interesting one. It's got card mechanics, which I have mixed feelings about. It can be okay. The card system or events is it basically makes the decision making that we're seeing in King of Dragon Pass a little more abstract, I guess. And a bit more gamey, but I can see why you're asking if I've played the Thayer games, because it is very similar to King of Dragon Pass in a lot of ways. The thing I have about the card system is that it causes issues. Oh, no worries, Variax. I'm just glad you turned up to say hello. It's fine. It's well worth the shout out. The card. What can I say about the card system? I mean, As I say, it abstracts the decision-making process quite a bit. You still have decisions to make in Thayer, but it often resolves by doing like a skill check involving card games. And I don't know. While I know RNG plays a big factor of the results of making decisions in this game, the results feel natural in this game. Even if RNG is working against you. When RNG works against you in card games, I feel cheated. Is it, though? Exactly the same... exactly like the first game, but with more the Sid Meier's Civ. They definitely lean into the city-building aspect more. I would have said it was more like the Endless games, Endless Legends in particular, or Endless Legend in particular, just because of the hero aspect of the game, from what I remember. It has been a long time since I've last had a look at Thayer 2, so I could be wrong about that. And of course, I haven't played it myself, so... You've never played the Endless games? Well, if you like Civ games, then you will definitely like the Endless games, especially Endless Legends, or Endless Legend. I can never work out. The downside to Endless Legend is that the... I think the expansion packs are a little bit too expensive for what they provide you. Basically, each expansion pack brings new game mechanics and one new faction. But the new mechanics have been a little bit underwhelming for the most part. And that results in the new faction also feeling a little bit underwhelming. Endless games, more like Endless DLC. Yeah, especially Endless Legend, because, yeah. Oh, and Endless Space 2, I think it is, that's gone a little DLC heavy. But, yeah, the thing... If you like Civilization, you know that each nation has its own, like, perks. The Endless games take that to a very, very strong extreme. Each faction in the Endless games plays incredibly differently. And when it comes to like the DLC factions, they usually play strongly into the new mechanics that are introduced into the game. Paradox, grand strategy game player. The Endless series is light on DLC. I mean, yeah, you're not kidding by comparison to EU4 or Stellaris. Oh dear. Right, so we are give gifts to the Orlandi. Yeah. Give them goods. Give them 30 goods, I think, and a bit of food. Can't give them too much food, considering our situation now. But, Lorebot, you will definitely like Endless Legend then, because each of the factions has its own story to follow. And part of that is what... You know, that just even makes them each faction even more unique. Paradox Games are beyond endless. on DLC. Yeah, no kidding, Namaxis. The stories that you get in the Endless series they can be quite bleak, but they are fascinating to see. Even factions, I've forgotten the name of the faction in Endless Legend. The I think it's Hivers. Basically, the giant insects that reproduce by infecting corpses and mutating the corpses into more of themselves. Even their hive mind society, there's an interesting story being told in that. So yeah, if you like story, then yeah, Endless Legend, I would definitely recommend. Anyway, second turn of Earth Season. There's not a whole lot we can do right now. I guess we could explore the Tula again. Might as well send Aslandar out, get him training. And he's found some goods. Okay, we spent some time in the wildlands of Artula. We didn't find anything strange or unusual, but we did find 8 cows worth of old bronze armor. And he found more bronze armor. Jarnandar, trader of the Vanstach clan, is dead, laid low by a Trollkin ambush. He'll be remembered in our sagas for his long dispute with a rival trader, our killer of the Kurandoli clan. Ah, yes, I remember that. Ooh. Vandal, one of the men who admitted to being with the mysterious woman in the woods, is stricken by a ghastly seizure. Plant tendrils burst out from his mouth, ears, eyes, and through his clothing. Within minutes, he's dead. Ouch. Can you get endless herds? Actually, you make a joke about that, Namaxis, but there is a faction in Endless Legend that is a group of traders that use pack animals to migrate, and they don't have any permanent settlements. If I remember correctly, there's a penalty for staying too long in one place with that faction. I haven't played around with it too much, but yeah. There you go. Endless herds. Anyway. So, what do we say here? Anyone who has contact with the Woman of the Woods must come forwards. Do we cast a curse-lifting spell on all the men of the clan? Cast a curse-lifting spell on all clan members? Do we cast a curse-lifting spell on the men who admitted to contact with the Woman of the Woods? Do we do nothing? Do we sacrifice to an elder for help? Someone got branched. Better start checking for saps. The people are distressed. They'll be more distressed if we do nothing. If any married men were with the woman and admit to it, they're confessing to a crime that demands they be outlawed. Like the growth of weeds, a curse of the Uldriyami is fast and very difficult to stop. The folk name for the Uldriyami is elves. It's the elves again, although this is the first time they've actively worked against us, so yeah. Counter spells against foreign magic are unreliable, but it's the best we can do. How I wish these foolish men had ignored her. When I get my hands on the creature, I'll chop her up like a parsnip. Fincott's men were camped in the hills of peace. Wood women went among them and planted them men with seeds. Hundreds died of the curse. Yet now you tell us. Okay, so we're going to have to cast a curse-lifting spell on all the men of the clan. Because they're not going to admit to committing adultery, and I don't particularly want to outlaw them, so... yeah. We lose more magic. The curse was not repeated. Oh, mood! The Orlundi extravagantly praised our gifts. They toasted me in their feasting hall, drinking far into the night and singing many rousing songs with me. As near as I could tell, they held us in high esteem. Bostor, a trader from the northern kingdom of Tarsh, is touring Dragon Pass in search of carls willing to leave their clans for farming opportunities in his farm homeland. The carls of your clan listen to him with great interest. There's much good land ready for the taking. You'll be safe from raids and safe from many inhumans, monsters and foreigners who bedevil you here in Dragon Pass. Our king has declared that every new farmer who settles our lands will get a herd of 30 cows. We must let them know that they're free, but also that we want them to stay. Let me talk to the carls. I can explain to them that they will be cut off from the spirits of their ancestors if they go. Vostor's offer is tempting to many of our carls who are unhappy with the decisions we've made of late. I told you the Tarshites would try to steal our carls. Although Vostor is a cunning salesman, I can show how he exaggerates the benefits of his proposal. Vostor's offer is tempting, okay, and when bad King Urgrain lost the chalice of Arnalda, his carls wished to desert him. He said he would hunt them down and kill them if they did, so they stayed, but plotted his downfall. Right, Ennant, I believe in you, heroic bargainer. Convince the carls that there is a hidden catch to Vostor's offer. Carls agreed and would not go with Vostor. They praised Ennant's sharp eye for chicanery. We decided that he was exaggerating, making a loan of cows sound like a gift. Yeah. And here we go again. Another attack on our trade. The uneasy peace is the Colimar and the Velisi. Right, okay. The Velisi, we don't have that many contacts with, unfortunately. Okay, so Meniski, King of the Velisi, and plans to cripple Colimar, or that offer the King of the Colimar, promises to obliterate Meniski. Right, okay. Oh, the King of the Colimar has changed, I think. I don't remember it being Ophir. So, right, okay. Offer to broker peace between the warring tribes, right. So who goes out to the Velisi? Well, I think that's going to be Ennant. And we'll send King Derek to the Colimar. The Velisi king would not hear of peace. Derek was fine, though. Okay, right. Onwards. Now, what do we do at this point? Magic. Still got the blessing of Yinkin going, or friend of Yinkin, rather. I guess we could get the sun blessing going. Get it going early. That should help. One good less. I think it's time to send a blue tunic to some. make them argue over its colour. It sounds like an internet meme gone very, very wrong. Right. So, That's that. Odela. We definitely need to reduce spoilage. There we go. Sadratha, one of the explorers you sent to the far northwest, reports back. We found a land called Tarsh. A little different from us, but still know the laws and stories of the gods. While there, we were approached by an odd and dandyish fellow who called himself the Prince of Masks. He said that if we gave him silver and gems worth 50 cows, that he would visit a magical catastrophe upon any clan in Dragon Pass that we choose. There's much to admire in this fellow, says Gornagar. So do we agree to his proposal? Do we bargain with him? Do we forget the incident, send a party to attack him, or tell another clan about him? Telling the another clan about him sounds like a disaster waiting to happen. We've been cut off from the lands to the north for centuries. There's no telling what strange magic might be known up there. He's a haughty fellow and will be offended if we try to bargain with him. So offended that he will refuse to deal with us at all. Hiring foreign magicians to vex one's foes is not illegal, but I can't think of any great kings or heroes who would have done such a thing. He hasn't told us exactly what he would do to our enemies. His offer is too vague. We have no assurances that his magic even works. Hire him to curse one of our enemies. We should curry favour with another clan by telling them of this opportunity to harass their foes. But we must choose a clan which regards us favourably, or they will take it wrongly. I guess if we do tell another clan that we should tell a clan that we're allied to. But whom? Who gets to know about it? Or we could just forget the incident. So the Moldings, or the Orlognurst, both Kolimar tribe, but not king of those tribes. So, yeah, don't really want to give that information up to them. We could... Maybe we shouldn't give it to the Herani either. Yeah, I think we should forget the incident, because this is not going to go so well, I don't think. And I don't think we can use it effectively as a tool to curry favour. Our war leader, Slindar, said that he would not forget that we passed up an opportunity to settle an enemy once and for all. Doesn't really matter that much, but oh, here we go. The children of the clan, boys and girls alike, have begun to grow beards. The people are worried. They say it must be a curse of some kind. I wonder if their hair will soon turn grey soon, says Gordengar. So do we conduct a divination? Do we send for shamans to break the curse? Do we say the beards will fall out if we're patient? We're not full prey to this shamanistic ruse. This stinks of the cursed greenwings. We must conduct a divination to see who is to blame for this. All diseases and curses are sent by bad spirits. or enemy gods. Sometimes bad spirits do the bidding of mortal men. We should wait and see what happens. I mean, yeah, to be fair, this doesn't seem like a bad situation right now. It might be worth considering if it continues. But yeah, the girls in particular are going to be a little bit upset. You remember seeing the bearded lady? Yeah. I think she's passed away now, because I haven't seen her in years. Because a little while after you visited, I found out that she was working in one of the stores in the town. And I used to see her every time I went in there, so there we go. Anyway, yeah, I think we should let the beards fall out in time. I'm sure that's what's going to happen. But it is now storm season, so... yeah. I think that is pretty much... Bearded lady, yeah. It's a bit of a shame, because she wasn't a horrible person or anything. It's just... And it was kind of cruel that everyone sort of made it kind of a big deal about it. And I have seen tourists taking photos of her on their mobile phones, which I always thought was in a bit of bad taste, but... eh. She's definitely a conversation piece, to say at the very least. As I say, she was a nice person, so... or nice enough, anyway. And it certainly didn't... she didn't let it get her down at all, so... more power to her. But yeah, as I say, I haven't seen her in years. Anyway, let's see, what can we do? Let's not go to war again just yet. I think we should just skip this turn. I kind of want to get the number of goods above 1,000 again, and there's nothing too vital that we need right now, so yeah, let's just skip this turn. There we go. Our children awoke yesterday morning with hair on their pillows and not on their faces. Those dreadful beards that appeared so suddenly are gone. At least they fell out for most of the children. There are still three little boys whose hair stayed in their on their faces. Our healers finally calmed boys down, and the three were very well behaved all day. Finally, their beards fell out this morning too. All the children are laughing and playing again. Oh. Bad news. People are distressed. The skeleton of a brew was found near our Tula's boundary stones, and everyone knows this is a bad omen. That is bad. Okay. So, that is that. Right, I think I'm going to take another break. So, yes, so for those of you on YouTube, take care and have fun.